So Lord Iltari has a subscribe star also known as the Paladin. I would really recommend anyone who's invested in this story to go over and check it out. It's a solid way to help support the author and help get stories like this written, so check out the top link in the description. Be me, Paladin, master of dungeons and presumably also dragons, Beecastor the Volcanic, Peregrine the Hopeful, Andre the Inquisitive, Julian the Clever, Senkit the Indomitable, and the Order Watchful. The party rests in the newly purified glade after a fierce battle against a Banshee Queen and her court, looking over the ashy remnants of the tree which up until a moment ago held a shrine to Selhaedin Moonbow. Now only the silver bough remains, laying in the moonlight. Julian sets Andre down as he looks at the destruction. What in the nine hells and the abyss was that? He asks again. The rest of the party look at him very worried. If the Arcanist doesn't know what the giant claw of evil darkness that kills things at a touch is, it's probably extremely bad news. It was humanoid, but with horns, blacker than night, and it stood as tall as the tree. Andre says as she puts away her swords, shivering slightly still from her brief trip to the Shadow Fell. It was barely next to me for more than a second, and it felt like something had trampled on my grave. Peregrine looks the elf over, and places a hand on hers. It did more than just feel like it. You're cold as a corpse and this energy feels familiar. She did just pop out of the Shadow Fell, it's probably residual energy, Julian mentions, and it's the same kind of energy as your smites, so it probably should. Makes sense. Senkit says, looking at the dead tree, this is basically what would happen if you had some deep vendetta against some particular foliage, she says, completely seriously, to the small paladin, who laughs it off. I'll be fine. Andre protests, I just need some rest. The fact that she is still dripping blood from her eyes, ears, nose, and mouth, has a patch of frost over her heart, and is leaning quite a bit on Julian to stay standing says that yeah, she really needs some rest. Julian puts a hand on her shoulder to heal her, and his face grows grim. Aside from the damage to her brain and chest from the Banshee, her entire body has suffered low-scale degradation. Simply being near this monster was enough to start annihilating every cell in her body at once. He pours everything he has left into her and turns to the others. Our priority needs to be the university. I have no idea what this thing is, but it is dangerous on a level unlike anything I've ever seen, Julian says, and there is no room for debate in his voice. The others reluctantly nod in agreement, the small tendrils of fear rooted in their stomachs, despite their best efforts. It's late, we'll rest here, Kaz says, heading back towards the residences. Though long abandoned, the living homes are still in excellent condition. The party borrows a long abandoned house large enough for all of them, including Rike, who ran and hid when the Banshees showed up. As the party goes off, Andre pauses and picks up the silver bough. With the altar gone, this is all that remains. She looks to her old bough, the wood and string wasted away by the strange monster's destructive aura. Even her tunic has holes like moth holes in it. Mind if I borrow this? She asks her goddess. There isn't a direct answer, but she feels a ping in her mind as the bough attunes itself to her. A single strand of Andre's long white hair falls from her head, wraps around her wrist and bends the bough as a new string, then unbends itself and wraps around the grip. I'll take that as a go-ahead then. As Kaizen Sen are stowing their armor, he turns to her. By the way lass, what did ye say to me after ye got me up? Sen stops, I don't recall saying anything. Maybe I did, but with the fight and that thing and everything else, it must have slipped my mind, she answers. Kaz shrugs it off and beds down, still wondering what it might have been. In the morning, the party rises from a peaceful rest, eats a quick breakfast, and then hoofs it back down the sewers to the cathedral. And then from the cathedral back down into the kobold den in search of Sylvester, the local midge. Julian decides to be the one to speak with the reptilian sorcerer, Arcanist to Arcanist. Sylvester is the party's best shot at getting to the university and finding their way around it, as he has been there before. The Arcimer stoops as he steps into the midge's small bedroom and laboratory. It isn't much, but there's a small alchemy kit made out of salvaged pieces with various things boiling over tiny fires. There's a small shelf full of potions of dubious quality, but Julian decides not to mention it. The diminutive magi himself is busy poring over a spellbook, one far, far too ornate and well documented to come from the kobold. Sylvester turns when he hears Julian enter. "Oh, the Asima. What do you want?" it asks him. "To go to the same place where you found that spellbook, the old university." Julian responds, getting right to the point. "No, you don't," the kobold responds grumpily. "You've already got that spellbook, and even I can smell that there are things in that more powerful than just about anything normal people can do. Unless you can find the headmaster's book, I doubt you'll find anything useful." Sylvester responds, staring at the bag where Julian keeps his mother's old book. "What? No, I think the most powerful thing I have in here is second tier, unless Erbur is stronger than I thought. UBW, it lets you make a copy of yourself?" Sylvester says, fascinated. "Is it just a phantom or a record like glass mirror image?" No, I mean maybe it could if I wanted to make a statue of myself out of bread. All it does is conjure loaves of bread," Julian says. "Or wait, no, it's just summoning bread, and there's no transportation." Therefore, Julian looks at the silly little spell in awe as he realizes he's essentially been using creation, but exclusively limited to bread. "Wait, no, it's not creation. It sticks around. Wait, that would mean..." Julian is dumbstruck as he realizes that unlimited bread works is in fact a spell that permanently creates matter out of thin air, something that is far beyond mere fifth tier magic. "Unbelievable. She gave me a spell of divine power beyond the normal capabilities of mortals, and it exclusively creates bread. For anyone wondering, unlimited bread works is in fact seventh tier magic. In this world, third tier is relatively common as far as magic goes. Most people with the talent can get to this. Fifth tier is rare, but not unheard of, usually considered enough to be considered a master or quite talented. Seventh is the dominion of the best and brightest. A caster of the seventh tier is probably the best magi in a kingdom. Anything beyond this is considered more akin to myth and divine intervention, the nearly mythical acts of legendary figures. So in short, Julian's bread conjuring spell is probably the most powerful spell anyone who sees it is ever going to see." Julian sits down as he realizes this, totally flabbergasted as he realizes the enormity of that gift. Then he realizes how the gods knew this, and knew he wouldn't think about it, and now that he is thinking about it, they know he's flabbergasted, and are probably having a good chuckle. "Halflings, even when they're gods they're still halflings," he groans, then brightens. "Say, Sylvester, here's a thought. I'll let you copy that spell if you lead me and my friends to the university," he suggests. He was planning on giving it to him anyways. The ability to create food like that would be a huge boon to this tribe and secure their loyalty, as well as enabling them to advance. Sylvester looks at him, torn beyond belief. He looks at the bag and the spell in there with the kind of longing that wives wish their husbands look at them with. But he clenches his fist and shakes his head. "Can't use it if the thing there gets me," he says. "But I'll draw you a map." "Wait, what thing?" Julian stops him, but the kobold shakes his head. "Can't say its name, can't think it, don't even think about it or it will know. The eyes were the easy part. That thing, no. Sylvester says, muttering madly and shaking his head. "You're giving me that spell before you go, so if it gets you I still get paid." Julian gets an uneasy feeling in his stomach, but nods in agreement. Within an hour, he has a map, and Sylvester has a spell. He meets up with the rest of the party, a worried look on his face. It seems the university is not abandoned. There's something in there that has Sylvester even scared to think about it for fear it will know. "Is that just normal kobold cowardice?" Andri asks him. "Any cowards," Kazdor observes. "They just didn't have the strength, neither weapons and training we do. I mean, do you really expect everyone to stand up to hordes of orcs, Noah bands, swarms of banshees, goblin legions, and everything else? I mean, really. That is what we are here for," Senkit says with a smile as she watches a pair of youngsters chasing each other around, "to defend those who don't have any option but to run and hide, and make a day when they have the strength to stand on their own." Julian concurs as they set out along the tunnels, following Sylvester's map. After about 2 hours' walk, the party comes to a grate with a large gap in it. Well, large enough for a kobold. Seeing as the majority of the party are not kobold-sized, Kazdor decides to resolve the situation by enlarging the hole. And by enlarging the hole, he means pulling the grate out of its slot entirely. Blunt, but it works. Andri comments as the party enters. Once they take no more than 5 steps forwards, a hideous wailing alarm sounds throughout the chamber. At first the party think they've encountered more banshees, and attempt to retreat, but find their exit blocked by an invisible wall of force. If I get out of this I am going to flay the kobold, Julian mutters under his breath as he readies his weapon. The others follow suit, watching the narrow path before them for trouble, when a light appears from above, an indigo light. It is a good thing I looked before I cast. You're not the people I was expecting to be coming in that way. A jovial voice says from above. The party looks up to see a manhole cover slip open and see a dark-skinned man with a long white beard and a shaved head looking down on them. He is clad in very strange robes, and has weirdly indigo eyes. You could have simply come in the front door, you know. No, we didn't. We're new here, I guess you could say. Would you mind us coming up? Peregrine asks, putting away his swords. Not at all. I figured you weren't. There hasn't been a living elf here in a very long time. The man says, before throwing down a rope, which coils around Peregrine's waist and pulls him up. Castor, suspicious of this as he is all magic, grabs hold of the halfling's ankles, and is lifted up with him. It's a good thing I picked the lightest one first. The man mutters as he helps the pair up, before sending the rope down for the others. Castor and Peregrine look around at their surroundings. They are standing inside a massive library, 5 stories tall, with a domed glass ceiling. Books upon books are stacked in shelves, overflow on tables, and are piled in great stacks. Scrolls are placed anywhere there isn't books, so in short there is more paper here than anywhere else the paladins have ever seen. Julian whistles appreciatively. Been too long since I've been in a proper library. He remarks wistfully. HM, you didn't look like a midget first. The old man says as he looks Julian over. But appearances can be deceiving. He says with a knowing grin as he looks at the satchel where Julian keeps his spellbook, then at Bast, who hisses at him. Don't mind her, she doesn't like anyone. Julian lies, and seemingly dismisses Bast, instead sending her into the shadows between the towers of books. I am called Tyrion, what of yours? The party looks at Julian strangely, and the stranger chuckles. Names are powerful business, you can call me hello. This is my library. Though mostly through occupation rather than any deed or inheritance. I see. How long have you been here? Julian asks. The man doesn't respond, pondering it for a long while. I have no idea. I showed up after the blight destroyed the city and have been so busy with research and organizing all these books, not to mention dealing with nothics, orcs, gnolls, goblins, and thieving kobolds that I lost track of time. Wait, thieving kobolds? Would he have happened to take a spell book? Senkit asks curiously. Yes, a fairly minor one, but he also stole a textbook on alchemy too, so I'm rather cross, especially after the gnolls made off with my alchemy jug. The man says with a harumph. The party shares a knowing look. If Sylvester didn't even want to think about this man, then there is more here than initially meets the eye. Just out of curiosity, what did you threaten to do to him? Julian asks. I threatened to turn him into a gnome. Yep, that'll do it. Peregrine nods, remembering the miniature midge's deep and abiding hatred of anything that even vaguely resembled a gnome. Now, why exactly are you all here? Halone asks, getting back on topic. We need information, specifically about the Blight and the Shadowfell. Looking for a cure, are we? Interesting. Yes, they do have some notes on the Blight and plenty on the Shadowfell and their inhabitants. I believe that's up on the 3rd and 5th floors, follow me. As the paladins walk on, something without eyes watches from where it lays completely flat and hidden in a shadowy corner atop another pile of books. The eyeless watcher slips to the ceiling and follows them, always flat against the shadowy ceiling. The librarian leads them up a nearby staircase, then across the rounded upper floors towards another set of stairs. As they walk, they see a large glass display case with the glass part broken and whatever was inside missing. Mire thieves. Kazdor asks curiously. Oh that, no those things broke themselves out. Magic's a living thing, and every once in a while a magic item starts thinking. I suppose a cloak of wings doesn't like being left on display. Shame, I quite liked those things. Kazdor rumbles discontentedly. He isn't sure how to feel about sentient magical items. Would an item made for a specific purpose be more like it, so a sword would naturally want to cut things? What if they didn't want to, like a flying carpet that was scared of heights? Not that he'd blame the carpet. The party walks along and soon sees another magical doodad, in this case a broom sweeping the floor without anyone sweeping it. To be expected in a magical university, they suppose. As they walk upwards past it, it sweeps by, pausing briefly by Peregrine. As the rest of the paladins pass on, it pokes at him and sweeps, follow, out in the dust, before sweeping away. The curious halfling follows, while the eyeless watcher continues to follow the party. The party travels up another set of stairs and he leads them to a section containing a tall bookcase labeled Shadowfell. This is everything they had on the Plane of Shadows. Their research on the blight is another two floors up. You go on ahead, I'll search through here. Julian tells the party, perusing the titles and the authors with a happy smile on his face. Once they leave though, he pulls out his reagents and begins to cast Detect Magic. Peregrine follows the broom, which leads him to another pile of books, and then flies up over it. Curious, Peregrine tries to climb the stack but slips off. The broom swoops in and he lands on it. He chuckles as he realizes he's now riding a flying broomstick, but his smile fades as he summits the book mountain and looks down on the other side. The rest of the party heads up the next two sets of stairs when Undri hears something behind them, like cloth trailing on a floor. She whirls and looks behind her, but the hall behind them is empty but for the piles of books. They proceed to the top, where he alone walks them by a series of tables piled high with notes. Julian completes his spell and looks at the bookcase. Every single book has abjuration magic on it, in a thin line. He takes one down and looks at it. Based on the thinness of the magic and its position near the front of the book, he guesses that the first page is most likely trapped. He grows intensely suspicious and begins to turn towards the staircase to follow the others. Peregrine looks down on a pile of corpses hidden behind the books. Orcs, goblins, and gnolls, really not anything special aside from them being hidden away like this, and their cause of death. Every single corpse and skeleton in this pile has had a large hole cracked in their heads. It looks as though they were all either executed by ice pick, or possibly a bird's beak. A cold dread sweeps over Peregrine. No, not a bird's beak, a squid's. Horrific stories of brain-eating eldritch beings, hungering for knowledge in the minds of humanoids, creeping aliens with strange powers, including the ability to deceive the minds of their victims and take disguises. Mind Flayer, he shouts, the words of warning echoing throughout the library. The paladins near alone go for their weapons as he whirls and fires a blast of lightning at them. Undri and Cass dive clear, only mildly burnt, and Senkit get her shield up, deflecting it. Irritating, Halone mutters in all their heads, I was hoping I could deal with you one by one, but since the halfling is wont to stick his nose where it does not belong. It grumbles as the monster sheds its disguise. The creature is about the same height, with extremely pale flesh that looks as dry and dusty as his lunar homeland. Its eyes glow an arcane indigo, and it seems frail, almost skeletal. Kazdor lets forth a cry and charges forwards, axes at the ready. He towers over the illiterd and brings his axe down on its head. The axe is deflected by a magical shield, but just barely. The alien dodges to the side as his second axe sweeps in. Kaz whirls undetted and finally lands a solid hit directly between the monster's eyes. It smashes into the dry tissue and breaks it in a swirl of dust. An axe. Really? Idiot brute. The illiterd responds as the dust swirls back together into its body, completely repairing the damage in less than a heartbeat. A loud whoop sounds throughout the library. Kazdor staggers back, unable to move, unable to think. His back hits the old balcony separating him from a five-story drop. Kaz. Undri shouts in concern and draws back her silver bow. Arrows lodge themselves in the illiterd's chest, staggering it. The blessed bow infuses her weapons with magic, halting the creature's regeneration. But it steps forwards. Magic. It is still insignificant. It responds, before backhanding Kazdor. Still reeling from the Mind Flayer's psychic assault, Kazdor cannot steady himself, and slips over the balcony. Kazdor Glamdring falls. Be me, Paladin, furiously annoyed at Halome for mind whamming me and leaving the last chapter off on a cliffhanger. Be Julian, Senkit, Undri, Yort, and Peregrine, Paladins all very annoyed at Halome for throwing Kazdor off a five-story balcony. Be Kazdor, be wondering why there's so much wind behind him. Then it hits him, the floor that is. The huge dragonborn falls like a great red meteor and smashes into the floor of the university in a massive plume of dust and shattered marble floor. He groans as he rolls over, still alive but not in good shape by any stretch of the imagination. He pushes himself up onto his hands and knees in the middle of the crater he just made, still trying to figure out what just happened. Back atop the university's tower, Senkit watches Kazdor fall, and is helpless to stop it. Her stomach falls out from under her as the paladin tastes cold, bitter fear. The feeling flees though, as a diabolical wrath rushes in to replace it. Her horns ignite, crowning her in purple hellfire. Her golden eyes burn a bloodshot orange. Her mace ignites in whirling golden flames like a brimstone sun. "You're dead," she promises the Alhoun. A keen observation. "It doesn't bother me much," Halone responds as he watches her boldly out of the corner of one eye, focused on the plume of dust Kaz threw up. Senkit lets out a soundless roar and charges forwards to crush the Mind Flayer, shield raised to block any new spell that comes her way. "Block this," the Magus says casually and points a decrepit tendril. A single ray of green light leaps from his finger. Senkit takes it on her shield, and immediately realizes her mistake. Disintegrate turns her proud and shining shield to dust on her arm, along with an uncomfortably large portion of her arm. It falls useless to her side as the force of the spell throws her back on a trail of her own blood and ashes. Julian hears the sound from above and turns just in time to see Kazdor fall past. He lunges for his friend but can't reach him in time. Julian dives from the balcony, wings flaring, but is only rewarded with dust in his eyes as Kazdor smashes into the floor. Julian looks and sees Kaz still breathing, then looks to the book in his hands and soars upwards. He has an idea. Peregrine is already on the move on his newly befriended broom. He watches Kaz fall but knows the sturdy knight can weather it. For now, he is more needed up top. Eorp drops his invisibility and swings at the Urd, having been concealed this entire time. Not telepathically shielded though, and the creature senses his killing intent and slips away as the hobgoblin brings his gladius down, then cuts it across. He scores a perfect blow and cuts the monster's head from its shoulders, only for the head to immediately reform itself. Oh come on. That's just not fair. Life is unfair. Undeath even more so. Halone reprimands the hobgoblin before raising a hand and letting rip a blast of thunder, throwing the hobgoblin back deafened. "I am immortal. Your continuing resistance is futiara." His monologue is cut off as another two arrows lodge themselves in his back. Undri stands tall, silver bow shining. "Those wounds aren't healing. You aren't immortal, just another corpse powered by a canna," the Inquisitor informs him coldly. "And you are blind," the creature responds arrogantly as it drops a psychic shadow over Undri, tricking her mind into believing that she cannot see in case it isn't obvious. He's packing a different spell list than the VGM Alhoun. Kazdor's mind begins to clear, and he uses his magic to begin to heal his injuries. As the battered dragonborn recovers though, the Eyeless Watcher finally makes its move, soaring in out of the shadows towards their downed paladin. Senkit staggers to her feet, the flames of her rage cauterizing her mangled arm. "You're still dead," the indomitable tiefling responds before charging in. Her mace smashes into the Mind Flayer's ribs, then his face, engulfing it in golden fire. The creature howls and turns to mist, reappearing further away and shedding the fire. "Hey, librarian," Julian calls as he flies upwards. The Alhoun turns, and Julian hurls a book at him. A book opened to the first page, one which gleams with orange runes. The Magus realizes his mistake a moment too late, and goes flying as his own glyph of warning goes off in his face. He staggers to his feet as Julian throws his other book. This time though, the Illiterd is ready, and the wave of his hand dismisses the magic. The destructive power gathers in his palm, and he points it at Julian. "Not bad, amateur," he responds, before blasting Julian out of the air with a fireball. The Arsimer goes flying all the way across the library and down the floor before smashing into a table laden with scrolls. Peregrine watches him go, and flies up, seizing the broom in his hands, and brings it down hard on the monster's head. Technically, the broom counts as an improvised magical weapon, and it actually hurts the pseudo-lich. The pseudo is important though, as Peregrine channels a smite, hoping against hope that it will work. Surprisingly, it does damage the undead, although only slightly. "Hitting me with a broom? A broom?" The Arcanist roars in insulted anger. Very well, if you troglodytes insist on dealing with things physically, so be it. Scarlet energy roils over the midge, as he stands upright. Undri feels the darkness slip from her eyes. Tensor. You really were a mad genius. The superpowered midge says, chuckling evilly. Down on the floor, Kazdor sees a dark shape coming at him and turns, swinging his axe at it. The shape flies back. Looking closely at it, Kazdor can see it is a great long cloak forged of dragon's scales. He thinks back, and remembers the shattered case. Oh, yield the wings and ye? The wings cannot speak, but draw closer to him. Kaz looks at them. Knee, dwarves were knee meant for flying. Kazdor looks up and sees how far it is to the battle, hears the thunder of magic and his companion's battle cries. He will not make it in time on the stairs. He looks to the wings, and nods. Right then. Let's get it over with. Yort comes in again, swinging at the monster with his gladius alight with lightning. Halone parries it with his arm, and then catches it, laughing as the divine electricity courses through him. He responds by breaking the gladius in half and punching Yort with enough force to send him flying once again. He reaches up with his other hand and grabs Peregrine by the face, slamming the halfling's head into the ground. The tile cracks, and blood fills the cracks. Undri, sight regained, fires again and again into the midge, hitting every time, but he just doesn't care. He stands up from Peregrine and blasts Undri with electricity, throwing her against the wall in coils of lightning. Senkit comes in and smashes his hand to dust to stop the spell, then turns and burns his arm off at the shoulder, golden flames licking near the monster's tentacles. Halone simply laughs and uppercuts her in the stomach. Senkit vomits blood and goes flying, smashing into the ceiling and dropping to the ground. Julianne returns, bearing more of the scattered scrolls. I might be an amateur, but I still know how to read these. Take this, Angazar's Scorcher. He roars, and the scroll in his hands becomes a roaring dragon's head composed of flames. It races forwards and bites down over the whole of the ill-heard, stunning him and blinding him. Peregrine staggers to his feet, and places a hand on Senkit's shoulder. Come on, it's not over yet, he says, healing her back into consciousness, even as his own vision flickers. Yort staggers upright, his jawbone sticking out of the side of his cheek. Despite the pain, he crawls over and heals Peregrine, stabilizing his vision. Undri crawls to her own feet and heals Yort in turn. Halone isn't focused on them for the moment, so they take the chance to recover. That is because the illiterate is busy wiping magma off of his face. Arrogant boy, he declares, as three sigils appear around him, blasting rays of scorching heat at the oncoming Asima, burning a hole through his leg. I am master of the arcane. I have conquered death itself, and you think you can kill me with a few measly scrolls? How about a few swings or an axe? A familiar voice says, "Dinny worry, lads, I'm still here." Kazdor-themed.mp3. Kazdor Glaimdring, dragonborn son of dwarven lords, flies from the floor, great scarlet wings upon his back and his axe is in hand. We need Armskinner. He roars, slamming his axe into the Alhoun and carrying him up into the ceiling with the sound of an anvil striking and a blaze of light and fire. Kazdor's second axe drives into the Undead's gut, nailing him to a support pillar, and Kaz lets his wings drop. The Alhoun and the Dragonborn plummet, the latter dragging the former down the pillar the whole way, the light of divine vengeance gleaming the whole way. A plume of dust swirls up from the floor for the second time that day, then is dispelled as Kazdor's third strike blasts it and the midge away. Halone goes flying through a stack of books, coming up looking ragged. You damn paladins, why won't you just die already? He screams as he looses another witch bolt at Kaz, who blocks it with his axes, and then tears the spell in half. Not our move, Senkit remarks sarcastically, though badly battered. She's smiling again as she hurls down hellfire to strike the midge, setting him ablaze yet again. The monster howls and leaps into the air to strike at them, only to be intercepted by Peregrine, who throws himself off the balcony to grab the monster by the tentacles. The halfling channels healing magic into the Undead, burning it away. Get clear, Julian shouts, and the halfling lets go, the broom sweeping in to catch him. How's this for an amateur? Lightning bolt. Julian asks the arrogant midge, before blasting him back into the ground with a storm of electricity. As it hits the ground, it staggers to its feet, body crumbling away around it. spell is almost all depleted. It looks for an escape and runs for the door, but stops dead in fear when it hears Kazdor land behind it. Where ye going, laddie? Ye seem so eager to fight when ye could throw me off a balcony. Kazdor says, laying a hand on the fleeing Mind Flayer's shoulder, gripping tightly. The Mind Flayer turns, and sees fire licking around Kazdor's bared fangs. The immortal life of Halom the Alhoun comes to an end as a torrent of dragon fire reduces the once mighty and proud Magus into nothing more but an ashy stain on the floor. Ashes to ashes, and dust to dust. Kaz hears the wings remark in his head. The item seems satisfied. Nay need for poetry there. But I concur. Good riddance to another blood image. Kaz remarks as he puts away his axes, the wings turned back to the cloak of scales, which fits nicely on the tall dragonborn, making his already imposing figure even more regal. The paladins reunite, and Senkit whistles softly at Kaz. You look good with wings, and damn, you really look like a prince with that cloak on now. Should I practice my curtsy? She jokes, then flinches from her injuries. Nay need for that, lassie, ye my friends, nay need for titles or formalities. Kaz responds, drawing near to her and laying a hand on her shoulder to heal her. She looks up at him gratefully, and they stare at one another for a long moment, before breaking it off. Well, at least now I won't have to worry next time you get yourself thrown off a balcony. She says relieved. Undri observes this quietly and smiles to herself. If you need lessons on it, you know who to talk to. Julian remarks as he heads back to the Shadowfell section. Though, I really wish just this once we could have found a place we didn't have to murder the inhabitants of. He grumbles, still smoking slightly from the fireball. The party makes a sort of camp and takes their rest, such as it is. Senkit looks at her arm, mostly healed thanks to magic, but still lacking her shield. I can't believe the bastard broke my shield. I feel naked without it, she says uncomfortably. So like you're at home, Julian says as he thumbs through his tome on the Shadowfell. Excuse me, what? Like you're back home in Chalt. You mentioned that your armor is specifically adapted for the climate. So it follows that if you weren't engaged in combat you'd go about completely nude for maximum heat release. Julian says, completely calmly and rationally. Kazdor snorts, blowing steam out of his nose. We do still wear clothes, Senkit grumbles. There's too many bugs and poisonous plants to go around naked. Then she smirks. And too many peeping angels. Julian rolls his eyes. Please, if you're referring to Aximand, he did a lot more than just peep. Bloody hypocrite. Peregrine looks up from his cooking. Glad to see the two of you getting on as well as ever. I'm too tired to fight him yet tonight, Senkit says as she yawns back, unclipping her armor and pulling off her breastplate. She gives Julian a pointed look as she is still wearing her tunic under that. Could you possibly fight him for me? The moon elf chuckles as she looks up at the stars starting to come out through the great glass dome that covers the university. She is rather glad that they didn't put any holes in it. Sorry, Sen, I'm beat, and it's too nice a night. Tell you what, I'll team up and help you kick him around tomorrow. Ye gods, a 2-on-1. Kaz, I don't suppose you'll come in and help even the odds, will you? Ardeni ken laddie, on one hand Darkney let a good warrior go down in an unfair struggle, and it's been a while since I kicked an elf in the jollies. On the other I'm certain Sen is a lassie, and a bonny fair one at that, and hitting a lassie's ungentlemanly. Hey, what about me? Andre asks, feigning offense. Ah, I'm still nae entirely sure if you're a laddie or a lassie yet. Ye canna tell with elves. You're all as flat as anvils, and your lads are too damn pretty. Undri turns mildly red. Eort pipes up, so you have an unrelenting desire to beat your iron upon her. Kazdor and Undri and Senkit all turn and glare at the hobgoblin, who wisely decides to turn invisible again, who frowns. If these were hobgoblins, that would have been hilarious. Kazdor is now glowing slightly red, though whether this is from embarrassment or from a deep desire to turn Eort into a pinata is uncertain. Ahem. Peregrine says, drawing the party's attention away from various thoughts of how best to slowly torture Eort to death. Wasn't there some famous elven paladin who was constantly getting mistaken for a woman? Astolfo of the 12, I believe. Undri groans. I still hold that he was a halfling somehow turned into an elf. We aren't nearly as wise and clever as we'd like to think, but that idiot was beyond the pale foolish. He certainly had fancy feet, and hands besides with how many different items he managed to steal. Peregrine chuckles, and how much trouble he managed to get himself into. The night goes on much as this, with the paladins sharing stories, making jokes, and generally having a good time. Julian even pokes his nose out from his books every once in a while. Drinks are poured, food is eaten. It isn't much compared with their feasts of old, but with good friends and bellies emptied by a hard-won fight, it's every bit as magnificent. The party rests peacefully that night, but in the dawn, they wake to find Julian already risen, looking grimly at one of the books they recovered. "I found what that thing is," he says with no emotion. The party gathers around it as they sip their coffee. On the page is an image of a great horned humanoid, with skin as black as night and baleful eyes. That was a Nightwalker. A creature I thought, I hoped, was nothing more than a myth and theory. Julian explains. They are creatures of the realm of Vantulife, the negative energy plane. How anything even remotely resembling life comes from that place I don't know, but they do. Much like how the walls between our world and the Shadowfell can be thinned, so too can the walls between the Shadowfell and negative energy plane be weakened. And things like this can slip through. So how strong are we talking here? Senkit asks. Bigger giant? Dragon? Worse. Julian says grimly. This thing is probably on the level of an Elder Elemental. In other words, stronger than anything but the very oldest dragons, and even then I doubt one would be able to take one uneasily. He sighs. If I were to reference it to something within my own field of expertise, I'd say it could probably take down a pit fiend, maybe even a Sona if it got lucky. A chill grows over the paladins' spines as they realize that they're facing down a monster as strong as the mightiest angels and devils. Even Peregrine starts to worry about their odds. There's a sound approaching, a thundering rumbling noise, as though mention of this great and terrible evil alone can draw wickedness near. What that? Julian asks, then shuts the book. Oh no, not again. He sighs as he realizes what's headed their way. He recognizes the sound of a whole bunch of very angry, hungry gnolls. How the hells did they find us? Senkit asks as she grabs her mace. Probably didn't, we just got unlucky. Time to go. Undri says as she grabs her gear and armor. The others nod and get their stuff. There isn't time to put on their armor, so they retreat into the sewers and run for the kobold warren. As they dash away, the gnolls break through, the great demon, like an albino hyena with a scorpion's tail, at their head. It sniffs around the library, and comes to the sewer grate. Again, they have a sanctuary there. It says as it looks around at its minions, including a particularly large gnoll. Enlarge this opening. I still have their scent. They will not escape us again. Be me, Paladin, Lord of all that is good in this world, and all this world's evil. Be Castor the Berserker, Julian the Caster, Peregrine the Rider, Undri the Archer, Eort the Assassin, and Senkit the Saber. Maybe Uryk counts as Lancer, but he's not tragically backstabbed by a jackass master enough. The party of heroes and Julian flees down the tunnels, putting as much distance between themselves and the oncoming gnoll horde as they possibly can. Of all the bad luck, there could have been so much to learn. Julian bemoans as they run. I just hope they don't try to eat the books. Less bellyaching, more running. Senkit reprimands him. Unless we plan on stopping being cowards and facing these animals, we might be able to fight an army in the right position when they come at us one or two at a time. Knee down here. Too many ankles. We need to find a way to trap them off and funnel them towards us. I'll work out the plan later. For now, back to the kobold den. At least that place is too well hidden for those idiots to find. Julian responds, and the party redoubles their pace, fully expecting to hear the gnolls being down on their heels at any moment. But no attack comes, and when they reach the hidden entrance to the kobold den, it's completely silent. Strange. Undri doubles back and sweeps the area to make certain they're not being followed, but no gnoll is found, not even a yip or a pawfall. If anything, the silence makes her even more wary, so once they are through the hidden door, she presses her ear to it to check for the sound of hidden scouts turning back. Nothing. Stranger and stranger. Back at the university, the Shuovsfer oversees the excavation and enlargement of the hold to fit its sizable bulk. The great white demon prowls around it as more demons devour the tile, earth, and stonework to dig into the sewers. It is slow going, even the more demons can't bite through marble easily. but they are making progress. The war leader, the Shuozva's supposed master, looks at the blessing his father has sent him in confusion. Why are we so concerned with a few scampering pieces of meat? They will not sate us. It growls. The Shuozva looks at him with enough ire to make even the massive warrior quail before it. Because our father has sensed that they will prove a problem. His plans for the cornering of this prey world are proceeding, yet his instincts have foreseen that these things may allow it to escape him. They are not like the things in the brimstone house though. No. Though I still smell brimstone on some of them. They're close enough. Order, the demon snarls. Its stench is unmistakable. Redouble your efforts. I grow tired of waiting with this stink in my nose and no flesh in my jaws. It demands, lashing out at a more demon with its tail. The living mouths dig in with increased fervor, driven by fear as well as their own overwhelming hunger. They will not escape us again. The Shuozva snarls a promise. Back at the burrow, the paladins don their armor and explain the situation. The kobolds are overjoyed to hear of the death of the Ahun, and also at Sylvester's new ability to produce food. As they talk, Urite takes Senkit aside. Lost shield? He says, pointing to her bare arm. Oh, yeah. The Ahun destroyed it while we were fighting. Senkit responds. Why? You lost it protecting us, killing a monster. Are you going to keep helping us? Urite asks, looking at her very seriously. Senkit looks at him, then around at the celebrating tribe. Yes, she answers. I am sworn to protect the weak and the faithful, and you're all certainly faithful with the way you kept the cathedral. Urike swells with pride, and then removes his shield from his arm. Special shield. Dragoness gave it to Matriarch years ago. Is for the person who protects tribe. You're stronger than I am, stronger than I can ever be. Will you protect my tribe? He asks solemnly. Senkit looks at the kobold very carefully. For as long as I can. I will likely need to depart soon, but for as long as I remain near your tribe I will protect it. She swears. The kobold offers her the shield, an old steel thing sized for a human, emblazoned with Mount Celestia, a dragon soaring above it. She takes it and feels the sudden familiar buzz of magic. This item is enchanted. She looks down on it. If this really did come from a dragon's hoard, that would explain it. She straps it on and joins the others discussing their next moves. I still find it suspicious that we weren't followed. Andri says. They tracked us across the city but don't pursue us when they finally catch up. You're assuming they're tracking us and they didn't happen to just run into the university while we were there. These aren't even necessarily the same gnolls. They wouldn't have even seen us and with as many different people must have gone through that university over the years it's probably already an ocean of strange smells. Julian counters. I'm inclined to agree with Julian here lassie. Gnolls are dumb creatures, but they're nae gonna be chasing us when this city abounds with Groby and Orcs to eat. We're nae really that big o' a problem. Kazdor concurs. Andri relents. Alright then, we plan on travelling above ground this time then. She asks Peregrine, who is looking over her map and comparing it to a kobold map. Yep. No real access from the tunnels anywhere near Town Hall except through the cathedral. The halfling reports. We should probably get moving now actually, the orcs won't be moving during the day because of the sunlight, he suggests. Right then. Let's get a move on. Senkit advises, and heads for the tunnel, the others following closely behind. They reach the cathedral without incident, the kobolds actually bowing respectfully and getting out of their way as they pass through. Nice to be getting recognition. Peregrine preens slightly. The party exits the building and heads quickly and quietly towards the abandoned town hall, dashing from ruin to stay out of sight, exceedingly wary. The wind blows cold out of the north, chilling them. Kazdor spreads his winged cloak and shelters Senkit and Peregrine from the chill as the party enters the building. The interior of the building is ravaged, so much that there are great holes in the walls. It's honestly a wonder that it hasn't fallen over. Nearly nothing remains, even the doorknobs and hinges have all been stolen, leaving rotting doors on the floor. As the paladins search through this testament to rapacious greed, in small corner of the eviscerated building's lower corpse, they find a room covered in books and paper. It seems that the ravagers tore through this place, but decided paper and leather weren't worth anything. The paladins start to search through the files. After about an hour, Kazdor finds something. Look single quote ere lads, it's a tariff record. He says, holding open a large book. It lists the goods, when they arrived, and where they're from. It's got imports firm fee Karen and Drake in Festug. We've got a lead. Excellent. Keep looking, maybe we can find more. Julian suggests, but they are all surprised when Urike dashes in, out of breath. Help Harnoles, they found an entrance. Trying to break down secret door. Help. The paladins go pale as they realize they were followed and they sprint back to the cathedral. Abandoning any pretext of stealth and just barely remembering to shut the great cathedral doors behind them. As they flee, a certain orc with rather wolfish features ducks for cover, having followed an all too familiar scent on the wind. When he sees them, he dives for cover, especially when he sees Undri. The orc ranger watches them depart into the cathedral, and limps northwest towards his camp, a wicked grin on his face. He will have his revenge. Back in the sewers, crude axes hammer and more demons gnaw at the wall which hides the entrance to the kobold tunnels. Spread out, scour the sewers. Send the flesh carvers and witherlings to swarm over everything to ensure they don't slip away. The Shuos Visnals. If you can, find another entrance and bring Mors to open it. It's only a matter of time. It purrs, drooling with anticipation. The paladins return to a war council in full force. The gnolls have found us. They are patrolling the sewers and the streets as well, and it will only be an hour or two before they are through the wall. A scout reports to the matriarch. Move the eggs to the central chamber and keep scouting for an exit. Why haven't we collapsed the tunnel they're coming down already? She asks. It's built into a lower section of the sewer, the stonework is too stable to collapse yet. We're rigging what traps we can, but even if we could, they'll get through eventually. The scout responds, Dragon preserve us. We may need to abandon this then, she says, and then turns to the paladins. A fine time for you to arrive. We need your help if we are to survive. I concur with your first statement. We need to evacuate somewhere safe, Julian says, looking over the map. The cathedral is large enough to hold all of you. You should move there. That may very well be, but then we are exposed. We cannot tunnel out of there aside from the old tunnel, and we will not survive long if we must move on the surface. The matriarch responds. It's also a matter of numbers, Undri says as she looks over the map. The gnolls will be able to find you fairly easily, and while they probably won't attack the cathedral directly, though they just might, they can completely surround it and starve you out. Agreed, even if they did not find us, we could not stay long in the dragon's house. It is large enough to hold us for a time, but not large enough to live in without us defiling that place, and it is also too exposed, too easy for orcs and gnolls to fight in. This den is perhaps the only place safe for us left in this city. The matriarch concurs, the numbers aren't in our favor to hold it. Even with the choky points, if you cut off every other entrance, we can't fight off an entire army by ourselves, at least not for much longer than about 5 minutes. Julian counters, you have to evacuate. Where are we to go then? We cannot simply live off the land and rations like you and your band. Almost half our number are young or still eggs. We must have a dwelling place or we will simply die later. There is one. Senkit says for the first time, drawing everyone's gaze. If we can get out of the city, we can bring you south to Hearthfire Abbey. There's still room there and creating a new burrow for your people would be something you could do in relative safety. That still means we must escape the city. If we try to move, the gnolls will find us and their numbers will still catch us and crush us. The matriarch counters. Not if we cull their numbers first. Can you bring down the whole burrow from a single point? Senkit asks. Perhaps if we made some adjustments, but that would take time that we need to move our people out. That wall won't hold for long. Then I will. Senkit responds flatly. It is not a grand vow, merely a statement of fact. She turns to the map of the burrow. When they break through, I will hold them. Undri can back me up with fire support while the rest of you get these people out of here and secure the cathedral. Once you're clear, we fall back to the entrance to the cathedral here and throw open every other entrance to bait as many gnolls as we can in. Then we drop the whole complex in on them and crush them. Ye'll have to face off against an army lass. I can ne'er allow ye to do that alone. Kazdor protests. No Kaz, you're the best expert we have on tunneling and stonework. You need to make sure the collapse goes off well and then fortify the cathedral to make sure we aren't attacked. I'm going to need to rest after this, So we'll need probably one night in the cathedral to recover and organize before we move out. Sen denies him. It's a good plan, the best we have, Julian admits. I say we take it. It's crazy, bold, and will make for one hell of a story, Peregrine says with a grin. And you're just tough enough, I think you can pull it off, Sen. I'm in. Then begin. Senkit orders her friends, and they set to work in a flurry of motion. Julian and Peregrine race back and forth alongside runners as the orders are passed on, gathering precious eggs and carrying them up to the cathedral. Kazdor takes his place directing the kobold workers in extending their undermining and creating a counterbrace which can be triggered from the cathedral entrance, then retreats with them to the surface to fortify the cathedral. Urik selects his dragon shields and readies a spare shield and goes each to another entrance, ready to throw open the gates and then flee. Sylvester goes to the surface and begins casting until his voice is barely a whisper, preparing food for their evacuations and going on beyond that. Senkit prepares in her own way as well. She goes to the tunnel the gnolls will come down. She can hear the demons snarling at the door, hear the mortar cracking and crumbling, every instant drawing nearer. She gets down on her knees, and Senkit prays. Heavens, watch over your humble slave, and grant me strength of arm and of body to weather the storm that comes for me. O great mountain, Celestia, may I be as immovable as thee, that those more innocent than I may depart. Angels heed me, though I am unworthy, and grant my plea. Give your speed to those who depart that they may flee even should I fall. Great Moradin, though I am not yours, heed this cry on the behalf of one who is, and grant him cunning and wisdom to ready this trap. Mighty Bahamut, though I am not yours, let your great wings shelter those who so dearly love you. Zariel, my great lady, king of knights errant and wandering, watch my battle and let this be worthy of one who earnestly serves you, great Valkyrie. O Celestia, do not let my wicked blood be the cause of destruction. Do not abandon those worthier than I for your vessel's flaw. Even if I am to come to destruction, let this penance spare the weak, even if in death I remain as impure as life, and my soul returns to the pit, let the innocents be spared this. She prays, the penitent knight, the infernal paladin pouring out her heart and soul for the sake of those she has sworn to protect. Senkit rises as she hears the walls begin to crumble, and the baying of the abyssal spawn as they see their opening. And Arvidor, if you can hear me, thank you for believing that a devil's child could ever come to anything. Likewise to you, Undri, that you would stand beside me. If I perish here, it has been an honor, she says, turning and smiling at Undri, and also at Urik, who drew near and saw her as the light of Nol torches pool in, their shadows dancing madly at the walls, Senkit's theme. Against the shadows stands a horned figure, a shield in one hand, a mace in another. In that mace is the light of a brimstone sun. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. A fiend's tail lashes, and golden eyes blaze. Come you sons of damnation, come and face the might of Ordo. Ordo. Ordo ut invicta. The gnolls answer her challenge, and the army of ravening beasts descends, howling the name of their gluttonous father. Mouths so thick with drool for the slaughter that their rabid nature is made clear. The first one pushes past his fellows and throws himself at Senkit, twin daggers in hand and a mad laugh in his throat. Senkit strikes him down with a single blow and cares not. The next follows closely behind, mace scratching off the enchanted shield and dancing away. Senkit throws him back into his pack, but the press of bodies is so thick behind him that he cannot fall. Senkit plunges through regardless, striking him down with two strikes. Silver streaks fly past her and nail another monster down as Undri nods. The first wave is broken. The second comes in again and again. The two Valkyries beat it back, frustrated by their lack of slaughter. The gnolls come on again, this time simply pushing Senkit back using their sheer weight of bodies. Her mace rises and falls, and crushes a gnoll, only for another to take their place. She strikes that one aside and meets the gnolls with a countercharge, using the bodies of the dead as a thing to brace herself against. She is close enough to one of the foul creatures to smell its stinking breath, feel hot panting on her face. It is like rotting meat, but the brimstone paladin is unshaken, and tries to gore it with her horns, though unsuccessfully. Undri hammers shot after shot into the horde, but it is like throwing water on a forest fire. The gnolls just keep coming, every time the two beat them back, but lose just a bit more ground. A few inches, a single scratch or distracting wound, over and over and over again for several long minutes that feel like hours. Senkit breathes heavily, and Undri's fingers are run raw by her bowstring. She can feel the draft of the larger chamber at her back and knows they have been pushed almost beyond this choky point. Senkit can feel it too, and roars with determination. Though her body is drenched in sweat, and to raise her mason shield feels a monumental effort, her determination will not let her simply retreat, or lay down and die. Her teeth grind to the point where she fears she may crack them, and pushes through the pain, through the countless scratches, through the dehydration and blood loss, and she retaliates. The Iron Maiden breaks first one knoll, then takes a step forwards, then another, and another, knolls falling before her as she gains a precious few feet back for the first time. Her breathing is ragged, but she moves her muscles out of the will that her body can almost no longer match. A single arrow flies from Undri's quiver, and as she goes for another, she realizes she is completely out. So many dead knolls line the passageway that it is nearly impassable, but there are so many knolls that the bodies are torn apart or trampled flat as the unstoppable horde marches on, baying with an unbreakable hunger. Almost 100 knolls have fallen in the past few minutes, but his is a horde with dozens of hundreds. They come on again and throw the exhausted Senkit back. Undri rushes forwards and braces her friend and cries out as the exertion Senkit has put her body through makes it so hot that it is painful to the touch. Sen's armor is tattered, to the point where it more resembles her original Chultan gear. Sen nods gratefully. If not for Undri holding her up, she would have fallen there. She strikes the knoll down as Undri channels what remains of her magic into her, keeping her alive for a few moments more. Their magic is almost all gone, smiting away the strong and healing the dozens of wounds, some minor, some not so much. Her vision flickers, black creeping in around the edges. We're clear, the gates are opening, fall back. She hears a voice, "Yrikes," she thinks, but it all seems far away. No. She closes her eyes and forces them open, dragging her back into reality as she finally gives ground in a fighting retreat to the main exit. Just a few more, just a few feet more. One. A single blow throws her from her feet and she crashes into the earth as a great and mighty gnoll, the leader of the band, at least in name, steps forwards. Having expended his minions to wear her down, he brings his flail down on her back, and there is a horrible snapping sound. Senkit's legs stop hurting, her entire lower body stops feeling anything at all. Senkit. Undri calls as she watches the paladin finally break, but is unable to reach her. The other paladins are coming down the main tunnel to relieve them. The kobolds are safe, they're finally all safe. They can get away and trap the gnolls, they just have to get clear. The gnoll leader brings down his flail again, and it is stopped by a shield bearing the mark of Mount Celestia. I am the servant of the divine. Senkit pants, as her spirit forces her body beyond its limits, and she gets up on one knee. Divine power blazes around her, magic beyond her limits pouring into her from an outside source. Above them, the scale of Bahamut blazes brighter than ever. I am their avenging sword and an unbreakable shield. I have withstood great trials to become their shield. I have borne upon me all the evil the world can muster, even knowing I shall never partake in the good blessings of the world. Her voice is stronger now, building to a shout. Though my body may lie broken, though my blood runneth out, while a bone remains unshattered, while a single sanguine drop runs through my veins, my oath remains, so too, I remain, beyond this weakling flesh, borne aloft by the grace of heaven. She warns, as she rises to her feet fully and though the gnolls leap upon her from every angle, none can touch her. I am the heir and vessel of a heroic spirit beyond your ken. I am their unflinching shield and unwavering bulwark. I am a paladin. I will not leave my oath unfulfilled. The heroic spirit of devotion surges through her and explodes outwards as she throws the gnolls back. Senkit stands, light in the ravening darkness, a washing glory. She takes one step, then another, pushing to the entrance and holding it beside Undri. The two retreat, step by step, as Kasdor and Yrike and all the rest rush to their aid. Dragonfire, spear, swords, smites, everything in one last desperate push to ensure that no one is left behind. The gnolls fall back and the paladins retreat up the hill, Senkit at their rear, unwilling to leave any in danger. They come to the final stand, Whether Trigulis, their Kazdor and Senkit stand side by side, and to draw near to them is to face death, Golas. I'll toss it and keep them back, Kazdor roars as he fights off the gnolls. The press is so tight about them that whoever crushes their support beam to drop the cavern will be unable to retreat in time. Senkit looks up and knows this. I'm afraid that won't be happening. I can't very well leave you here. Go, lass. I've made my choice. Ye are my friend and a hero. What could I call myself if I dinna leave ye pay the accolades o' the glory ye've won? He asks, and Senkit smiles at him sadly. I'm sorry I force you to figure that out, she says, and steps close, then slams her shield into his stomach. Caught off guard, the dragonborn reaches out in vain for her as she throws him clear, and then strikes the support beam above her. The cathedral shakes as tons upon tons of dirt finally come crashing down upon the gnolls. They rush for their escape, but the invincible wall of Senkit the Devoted stands between them, even as earth falls all around her. The light of Senkit shines in the darkness, and then the darkness overcomes her. Kazdor roars as he watches helplessly, then throws himself at the swiftly settling earth, digging into it with a blind fury, the kobolds and Undri rushing to join him, until they find her hand, and dig her free. Senkit's eyes are closed, and her body is mangled. She pushed herself far, far beyond what she should have been capable of, and the collapsing tunnel has left her broken. When Kazdor sees her, he falls to his knees and begins to weep. He takes her in his arms and cradles her as hot tears begin to fall for his beloved comrade. He pours everything he can into her, every drop of magic he can to try to save her. Her scars heal, her broken form puts itself back together, but still her eyes do not open, until after a long, horrible moment where they feared it might all be for naught. Senkit opens her eyes, and raises a hand weakly to wipe away Kazdor's tears. Come now, Kaz, you're a prince. Can't go getting all waterworks on me, it's not proper. Kaz smiles as he hugs her close. Nay, lass, he whispers. A prince who can ne weep, ne laugh, ne rage, he's ne complete. And a king can ne be incomplete, he whispers. Senkit smiles and lays back. Kazdor lays her on his cloak, and the infernal night passes into a well-earned rest. Be me, paladin, bard of glamour and keeper of a more fantastic age. Be the paladins of order undivided, Senkit, master of defense, Kazdor, master of fury, Undri, master of revelations, Peregrine, master of blades, Eort, master of shadows, and Julian Tyrann, master of war. Senkit lies in peaceful slumber atop Kazdor's winged cloak, the dragon scales wrapping around her to keep her warm. You should get some rest too, Julian advises, and Kaz shakes his head. Nee. Not while the enemy is still at our gates. Kaz responds, looking to the barricaded door, and the torches of an orc camp lighting in the sunset just a few feet beyond. When the paladins completed their evacuation, they found that the orcs had also discovered their use of the cathedral as a base and moved to surround it. Even now Undri looks at the assembled swarm, her keen eyes glaring at one particularly wolfish orc who walks with a heavy limp. You aren't going to kill him by glaring on. Peregrine advises her as he offers her a cup of tea. She takes it and looks out at the horde grimly. No, especially since my quiver is dry. I've got my Fletcher's kit, but there's not exactly a whole lot of wood here, let alone the metal I'd need to make a proper arrow. The elf responds as she takes the tea. Her fingers are raw and she's almost as worn out as Senkit from the last fight. She looks out at the horde worriedly. Why aren't they attacking? Superstition. I had an orc in my band when I went bandit. They're incredibly superstitious, and actually rather cowardly to boot. They won't dare attack a holy place like this, especially with the scale here until their shamans see the right omens, Peregrine replies as he sips his tea. So we've got some time to try to figure another way out of this mess. Undri says, smiling faintly. We'll get clear of it. They might have a god on their side, but we've got a few of our own, and the goodly ones tend to triumph more often than not. Worst case scenario, we all go to paradise a bit sooner than expected. Peregrine says, his cheery mood still unmolested by the dire situation. The normally infectious mood doesn't seem to rouse Undri. Yes, I suppose they would eventually kill us. Probably more as an accident though. She says, her amethyst eyes seeing dark places. Orcs do treat their playthings roughly. Sometimes they're inadvertently merciful. She says, clenching her fist around the mug, then shaking her head and setting it down. "I should go make certain preparations," she says, walking off to a hidden room. She gets out her satchel, and a smaller bag she keeps certain poisons in, and lays them out on the floor. "You know, normally when I see one of Karelin's children playing with poison, they're a fair shade darker." A voice comes from behind her. She whirls, going for her dagger, and relaxes slightly when she sees an old elven man leaning on his cane watching her. "Though you do have the eyes for it. I wonder if Lady Moonlight's been up to her old tricks. Who are you? How are you here?" Andre asks, very confused at what an old elf is doing in this presumably abandoned building, and instantly suspicious of some form of shapeshifter. "It is my house, you know," the old elf responds with a huff. "And since you're the guest, you answer first. What's driving you so scared that you're pulling out poisons in a house of worship? There is a not altogether small army of orcs standing at the door, and I need every arrow in my quiver, metaphorically speaking. I must protect my friends in the kobolds. Such a strange one, so dedicated to keeping joy in the world, but can't keep it in her own heart," the old man remarks. "Perhaps you should turn a bit of focus to yourself and keep away your own fear for once. But you haven't really answered the question. If you were scared of orcs, of death and even torture, you'd have married some fine fellow and settled down. You'd never have become a paladin, or at least not stayed one for long." Andre looks at him. "I took up the oath to protect others." "Yes, yes, that's obvious, but why? Why do you want to watch over these kobolds, this devil's spawn and this dwarf in a dragon's skin? You're going to watch them all die eventually, and their grandchildren, and their grandchildren's grandchildren. Because even though their lives are short, they deserve them." Andre responds, "Perhaps they will only have a century at most to live and laugh and experience all the joy the world can offer, but that is what they were given and they deserve every moment of it. And because I care for them," she concludes. "Even that insufferable Azima." "Good answer," the elf responds, and he walks out of sight. "Oh, and since you might need some more arrows, there's a clatter." Andre rushes to see what happened, but the old man is gone, and all that remains is a quiver laden with arrows, feathered with strange yellow fletchings. Julian meets her as she returns. He stands looking at the forces arrayed against them, eyes carefully moving as his fingers twitch, not looking at the camp, but some phantom battlefield only he can see, planning our way out of this. Andre asks him. He sighs, trying, "I've run 5 different scenarios, no successes thus far." He says with a sigh, "Breakout ends in failure, the numbers and layout is wrong. Holding up in here ends in failure, we run out of water. Sneaking out ends in probable failure with unacceptable losses, there's too many of us. Reopening the tunnel takes too long. Sending a person through ends in failure as well. We can't hold out for the time it would take to rally reinforcements. You'll find us a way out, you always do." Andre reassures him. "I hope I can, but still," he sighs, "maybe I get some of us out, maybe we can even get the majority of the kobolds out, but a battle like this," he shakes his head. "We nearly lost you and Sen against similar numbers, and there we had a choky point that Leonidas would have sacrificed his daughter and led an entirely different war for, and then promptly have gotten himself murdered by his own wife for," Andre says, earning a smile from Julian. "I'm surprised anyone still remembers that old play. We elves haven't forgotten the classics quite yet. Having the children of the original writers still around helps. Hey, I wonder if we'll get a legend half as glorious, or if everyone else will just forget." Julian looks. "At least the enemy leader will have the decency to come and die next to us. Well, we aren't dead yet. I do wonder still why Leonidas fought with so few though. Wasn't his city full of great warriors? The omens were wrong, his men wouldn't march for fear of angering the gods. Sounds a lot like these orcs." Julian hears that, and something clicks. His eyes go wide as a new plan comes together, and he laughs. He laughs long, hard, and maniacally. "Of course," he says with a cackle. "By the gods, we might actually get out of this yet. I take it you have an idea." "Oh, I most certainly do. Hells, Andre, I could kiss you for that. Past, you're not my type." Julian snorts. "Right, right, get yourself some rest. I finally managed to talk guys into some as well. We'll need everyone at full strength, but this might just work." "Wait, you're saying that this could actually work?" Kaz asks as the halfling gives his support to Julian's plan. Ye just call out their leader and fight him and they leave? Champion combat does happen fairly frequently with tribes. It's how most of the lizard folk and pirate clans back home settle things. Senkit offers. The sleep and the hallowed nature of the cathedral have done her a world of good. You couldn't tell she had her back broken less than 12 hours ago. Those are bloody civilized compared to orcs. Kaz continues to protest. They'll just attack us anyway straight after. Even if we were doing it, the wee laddie is probably the best one-on-one fighter we've got, so why would ye be fighting the Skinner? Because of all of us, I'm the one who can maximize the damage to their morale if I win. Even if they do attack, their resolve will be weak, and they'll be scared. We put up a good enough fight and they might forget they hideously outnumber us. Julian counters. Kazdor sighs. Well, it's better than waiting for them to just come to kill us, I suppose. What do we do if they do attack? We hold them in the nave. I terrify them. Senkit and Peregrine hold the flanks. You go over the top and Dundry supports you. Yort slips in where he can and uses his invisibility to target their leaders. We hit them hard and break their resolve before their numbers can overwhelm us. Julian responds, pointing to positions. Well, if ye are committed to this, the sun's coming up. I suppose now is as good a time as any to do it. I'll get the wee lizards ready to hide in the back rooms, out of the way of the main scrap. Kazdor agrees. Julian nods and the party assembles, going to move the civilians to the back as they prepare to make their move. Kaz comes back, and nods at the Usima. Give him hells, laddie. Julian grins back, and dons his helmet. The sun is rising outside the orc encampment. All night they have chanted, worshipped, and offered sacrifices to their one-eyed god. Their war chief leading them in the rites that they might improve the omens and be granted the good fortune they would need to finally tear down this house of the weaker gods. They look to the roof of the cathedral and see that their efforts have not been in vain. Two ravens stand atop the roof, only one short of a sign of good fortune. They cheer and prepare to redouble their efforts that the omens might be perfected when they see a figure step to the lip of the roof. It is a lone knight, wearing no sigil and bearing no tabard, clad in plate mail and a crusader's helm. A mighty sword is on his back, the golden aquila shining in the dawn. Several recognize it from the battle at the war wagon some time ago. Hear me, slaves of the blind god, Julian bellows. I grow tired of your cowardice. Let your chief step out and face me upon the field of battle, for he and all of you are too busy sniveling to come and breach this fortress. The war chief steps forwards from his horde and looks up at Julian. I would come and slay you, blasphemer, but I do not have the wings to fly. Calm down so I may break you. As you wish, Julian says, and steps from the cathedral's roof, plummeting towards the ground. He unleashes his wings, brilliant as the dawn, and lands unscathed, drawing his sword and leveling it towards the war chief. Here I am. You would depart the house of your god and face me? The orc chief laughs as he steps forwards, the spear upon his back still wrapped in cloth. Julian remembers that spear, remembers how it laid low his friend with a cowardly strike to the back. I have no god, Julian responds. So, can you use that spear for anything but cowardly attacks from afar while your warriors die for you? You are a fool, and a blasphemer. The war chief says as he draws the spear from his back. This was granted unto me in a flash of lightning, a gift from Grumsh himself. I will run you through, rip out your heart, and eat it like I did your precious pig. You will try, Julian responds. I offer you this one chance, and this to all your warriors. I shall pursue none who flee this battle before you strike against me, but attack this place and die. The war chief laughs as his warriors part back, forming a semicircular arena around him, and then spits in Julian's direction. The Arsimer's eyes flash, then perish. The drums begin to beat, and the orcs to chant as the two champions approach one another. From the cathedral, the other paladins watch as the war chief and war master face one another down. Orc theme. The two combatants rush to one another, meeting in a flurry of sparks as spear and sword clash off one another in a blur of motion. The war chief steps through the melee as Julian's sword slips back and smashes his fist into the Arsimer's breastplate. The steel crumples and Julian slides back with a broken rib. Undeterred by the injury, Julian rushes back in, driving the orc's guard up and then cutting across to score a long but shallow cut across his shoulder, then slipping clear from the counterattack as his foe lashes back with swipes of his spear and a roundhouse kick. The orc keeps his momentum, stepping forwards, stabbing twice with his spear. Julian deflects the first, then the second knocks his sword aside, leaving him open as the warchief hits him in the face with a high kick that throws him onto his back. Julian rolls clear as the warchief pounces, driving his spear into the ground where Julian was but a moment ago. Julian comes up and strikes back, only to be foiled as the warchief whirls his spear and deflects both attacks. Both step back into their stances and catch their breath for the briefest of moments, before rushing back in and coming out inconclusively, neither able to overcome the other's defenses. Julian pressures the orc hard, knocking aside his guard and leaving him vulnerable. He brings his great blade down in a blow set to cleave the orc in twain, but the orc backs clear, then runs up the blade and strikes down twice from above into Julian's shoulders, before leaping clear with a kick that knocks off Julian's helmet and throws him to the ground. The paladins watch as the orc brings his foot down on Julian's helmet, crushing it like a tin can under his foot. Kazdor rumbles, watching the fight but unable to intervene. He hears the orc's chanting and decides to answer it. Coming out of the cathedral, which acts almost as a megaphone with its high ceilings and great vaults, Kazdor's low, powerful brass answers the chanting orcs with a song of victory, his great rumble sending a buzz through the air. Senkit adds her own alto to the mix, and soon Peregrine's tenor and Undri's fair soprano join as the paladin's song stands against the chanting orcs. As the orc draws near to him, Julian uses his wings to fling himself up with surprising speed, headbutting the brute in the nose and stunning him. Now he has his opportunity, and throws the orc back with two might blows, carving an X into his chest. The orc rushes again, the spear cuts the Asimar's cheek, but he ducks low under the next attacks, then sweeps the ground in a circle, cutting the orc's leg. He springs upward with aid of his wings and falls like lightning upon the orc. Only a swift block keeps the brute from being shorn in two, but the pressure makes his leg buckle under him and he falls to a knee. The orc rolls away and comes up, the cloth flying from around his spear as its magic activates, lightning crackling in the morning mist. But even that crackle is quiet now, as the orcs falter in their song, allowing the War Master's anthem to sweep out from the cathedral and over the battlefield, as Warchief and War Master fall upon one another in earnest. Julian's theme. The lightning spear drives forwards as Julian soars to his foe. Greysword and spearhead strike off one another, then lock against each other. The stench of ozone fills the air as the two titans strain against one another, and then the Warchief launches a surprise kick. Julian dances clear and delivers a whirlwind slash that the spear barely catches, before slipping back on his wings, and diving in with a thrust that opens the Warchief's side. The orc roars as he steps forwards, and sweeps his spear up, throwing up dust into Julian's eyes. As the Asimar lands back, the Warchief runs his wing through. As Julian cries out, the orc delivers a vicious hook to his face, breaking his nose and throwing him back, but Julian does not fall this time. Instead, he lets go of his sword with one hand and sizes the orc's arm, breaking it with a pulse of red. He lashes out and his mailed fist hits the orc in the empty eye socket, making him howl. Still not done, Julian seizes his foe by the black hair and pulls him down as he flies up despite the pain inflicted in his wing to smash the orc's face in with his knee, throwing him back. The Warchief staggers and pulls back, shifting into a throwing stance to hurl the deadly lance and turn the tide back. This is precisely what Bast has been waiting for. Leaping from Julian's shoulder where Eort had hidden him invisibly, the familiar hits the orc in the face and keeps him from throwing for a brief moment. That moment was all Julian needed though. He lunges with a blow like no other, and while the Warchief's instincts allow him to block with the spear one last time. It is the last time though, as Julian's sword and the spear alike crack and splinter, nearly breaking apart but not quite. Lightning erupts from the damaged magical weapon, throwing off Bass and coursing over both fighters. A cat. The Warchief labors. A cat is what you bring to defeat me. I will use every weapon, every tool, every spell. Julian informs the orc as he presses harder. So that I might bring an end to this age, banish you and all your ilk, and consign your species to nothing but legends and half-forgotten nightmares, even your wretched god. You are an arrogant fool. The dying orc curses him. Perhaps, but I will free this world from the yoke of chaos, Julian swears, as he steps forwards. For even a fool can realize that this world has no need for gods of destruction. He utters his terrible oath, and the crimson path of his conviction manifests itself in the War Master's smite. Crimson force shatters spear and sword, the lightning ravaging across his wings dispels them. A flare as bright as the sun and red as conquest surrounds them, and when it fades, the orc barely stands, both arms turned to dust by Julian's smite. Julian plunges his left hand like a hawk's talon into the orc's chest and seizes his heart. "What did you promise?" "Oh yes," he purrs, before ripping the heart out of his chest in front of all his followers. Broken sword in one hand and heart in the other, Julian takes a single deliberate bite of his enemy's heart, chews, and swallows. He looks to the orc horde who take a collective step back, then crushes the heart in his fist. "Who's next?" There is stunned silence for a moment, and quite a few orcs, particularly those loyal to Thrawn, slip away, following the tactician into first retreat, then a rout. But as his fellows flee around him, one orc is too stupid to be scared. "Cowards, the great orc who wields them all, and thus shall be called Mauler," bellows. He charges Julian, who has but a moment to think, "Oh shit," before the massive orc hits him hard enough to send him flying into the air and through the rose window at the front of the cathedral. In that moment, the illusion is shattered, or at least replaced with a different one, as many orcs rally to Mauler. Perhaps fully half the horde has already been broken, but even half the horde is an uncomfortable number of orcs. Kazdor dives and flares his wings to catch Julian as he falls. "Well, it half worked. Great fight, laddie," he congratulates the Ursimer as he heals him. "Let's hope the other half worked too." "Everyone remember their positions?" Julian asks as he coughs up blood, then stands up anyways, using his own healing to finish repairing the damage. The rest of the party nods and takes up positions. Julian looks at his broken weapon and calmly summons his phantom copy instead. Perhaps the original blade may be broken, but the idea of the sword is invincible, something transient, a noble phantasm if you will. The doors shudder, then fly open as Mauler hammers them down, his orcs beside him as they walk, with no small amount of awe and contrition into the room, and see the paladins arrayed before them. "Now is the time, theme of order undivided." Side note, if someone can find me a higher quality version of this song without any of the sound effects and send it to me, I will send you the next chapter a day early. Seriously, it is impossible to find a good record of this particular cover. "Then begin. Order on me." The paladins and orcs charge one another, roaring their battle cries. Kazdor soars forth first, his cloak and him speaking as one on shared wings. "Velignat ihkve, kiobalat, ssdeath. He hits Mauler in the face, and throws him back into the throng with one axe, then soars above and disgorges his flame. Here in this hallowed place, with the Father of Dragons watching over him, his flame is something special, something new, something to rival a true dragon. The orcs turn away from the heat and light, but Julian does not. Charging through the flames, bereft of wings, the godless fool falls upon them. His phantom blade is in his right hand, and his left is still stained scarlet. The aura of terror is all about him, as he descends wreathed in dragon fire like a god of war, a blazing scourge unto his foes. He cleaves through two with a single blow, impales a third, then with his free hand grabs one by the throat and breaks his neck with a surge of crimson power. Against such terrible fear many rout before him, but Mauler remains, battling against Kazdor. He leaps through the fire and strikes the dragonborn, throwing him to the ground. Kazdor rolls to his feet and braces, stopping the barbarian's strike. The two massive warriors' blows send a shockwave through the entire building, the incredible strength of a berserker against the divine fury of Clandine's chosen. Two canary streaks strike him in the throat, courtesy of the masterful elven archer, who knocks two more to her bow. Some orcs try to flee the flames and the mad Ursimer around the side, those who run to the left encounter what may as well be a wall. Thinking their numbers can overwhelm the Tiefling, they fling themselves at Senkit. She tosses them aside like rag dolls, broken before her. Those who run to the right relax for a moment as they see nothing but a small halfling with two short swords. Roaring with bloodlust, they attack. They do not even see the swords that claim their lives, and some do not even realize they are dead until their arms and legs fall rotting off them. Kazdor holds his ground, and then smiles as he sees a familiar hobgoblin emerge from invisibility, wielding a borrowed spear. Eor drives his spear into Mauler's leg, just above the knee, and channels his divine power. A virulent poison rushes into the mighty barbarian's veins, the assassin's venom weakening him. Cass takes the opportunity and breaks through, striking the orc twice across the face, then once in the chest. Every blow rings out like a hammer upon an anvil, but even mangled the barbarian seems as suborn as an anvil. Julian continues to scatter the orcs before him. He is so successful those who are still heading into the cathedral are suddenly stopped by the orcs trying to get out of the cathedral and away from Julian. Upon seeing their icon stumbling and the practically demonic Julian in front of them, many of the reinforcements remember pressing business they have somewhere not here. Maula swings his maul and smashes the orc aside like a toy, then turns and hits Guys in the chest, lifting the big dragonborn off his feet and throwing him back into Undri. The elf dodges out of the way and places her finger to her arrow. Swift death to my enemies. She utters the famous phrase as she blesses her arrow with a thunderous smite, then looses it. The arrow strikes true in the charging barbarian's chest and lets out a shockwave that cracks the floor under it, but doesn't even slow the barbarian down. Senkit hears the thunder and turns. Seeing it, she reaches out her hand and grasps, finally stopping the barbarian as her indomitable will overcomes his brute strength. Sen. She hears, and turns to see Peregrine running at her and pointing up. Orcs above, he shouts, having seen a group that somehow managed to climb up to the balcony and are trying to get around that way. Senkip nods, realizing and braces her shield. The agile halfling leaps atop it and she shoves him heavenward into their path. I don't suppose you fellows would like to surrender and have some tea with you? He asks politely. The yellow snarls say no, and he sighs. Pity. The orcs charge him and he steps away from one clumsy attack after another, occasionally swatting one away before he retaliates. Walking through their midst, severing artery after artery and leaving rotted limbs and a swiftly growing pool of blood behind him. Nobody ever goes for the tea. Maula strains against Senkit's whole person, and sweat begins to bead on her face, even as Yort leaps up from behind him and drives the spear into his back, calling down a bolt of lightning onto him with it is a lightning rod. Even then the barbarian does not fall. As the spell cracks around him, Kazdor charges in and slams both axes into the massive orc's stomach, the force rippling through his body. Even still, Maula strains one last time, before Kaz takes one step forwards, and with a mighty effort and a roar of exertion, he rips the barbarian in half at the stomach. Then, and only then does Maula finally die. With the orcs broken before the man the path out of San Jonas mostly clear, the paladins look to the dawn of the new day, grinning in triumph.